ON1 recently released an update to their software, so we are now at ON1 Photo 10.5. Now, for those of you who purchased the mask training in the Nicolzi store, I wanted to show you a quick demonstration of how the new Perfect Brush features work. So this is one of the photos that you'll see in the training, and I wanted to use it because I wanted to kind of focus in over this hair. It's a really good way to see how these new Perfect Brush features work. So I'll go ahead and zoom in to 100%, and I'm just going to scan over to this hair area. I have the top layer active, and this is the layer that I want to mask on. And below it, I have just a simple pink layer, so you can actually see the mask as I actually create it with the Perfect Brush. I have the brush tool active as well. And at the top, I have that Perfect Brush active, and you can see that by the little blue icon showing at the top. By the way, you can toggle your Perfect Brush by using the keyboard shortcut Command-R. The feature that was added is not necessarily visible at first glance. So what you're going to have to do is click on this gear icon at the top, and then you'll see that there is a color threshold and a transition, and that is what is new to 10.5. Let's start with color threshold. The color threshold setting will determine how many colors are actually being sampled underneath the cursor when you use a Perfect Brush. I'll go ahead and hover over to the right, and I have it set to 0 to start out with. So that little minus sign right in the middle of that cursor is where the color is being sampled. Right now it's set to 0, so if I were to click, it's going to only sample that probably a very small amount, maybe even just a few pixels below that little minus sign. And if I were to move my cursor around, it's going to constantly find that color below, and it's going to add more to my mask. And of course, I can always hold that Command or Control key, click, and then drag, and it's going to just maintain that one singular sample that I selected. So we're not getting a lot of masking done here. This is not something you want to use the setting of 0 if you want to do a large amount of masking. This is a good thing to use if you wanted to get in to the details and maybe just kind of get rid of some of these little hairs. Even so, a one setting of 0 is not going to accomplish very much, so you're going to probably want to play with that. I'll go ahead and reset the mask. Now let's bump this setting up to 50 and let's see what it does. So now, at a setting of 50, it's going to sample a considerably larger amount of color. I can only imagine that this is what the default setting was before they actually made this change to 10.5. But you can see it's actually removing a lot. If I click down here at the bottom, it's not only going to remove the white or the gray background, it's also removing a lot of those little fine hairs. So it's not a really good choice if you're doing fine, intricate hair or any other type of detailed masking. I'll go ahead and reset that mask, and let's go ahead and bump it up all the way to 100 and see what happens. So at 100, it's not going to only sample a small portion from inside of the cursor. It's going to expand. And the best way to view this is if I go over here, over next to this ear, and click in the gray area, it's finding other colors to sample from. It's kind of expanding on that white tone, and it's finding some of those lighter tones inside of that ear. So I'll undo that so you can actually see what it looks like. And I'll do that one more time, just tapping once. And it's removing a lot more than just that small area of the cursor below the minus symbol. Now, the setting you are going to want to use is really going to be dependent on the type of image that you're masking and how detailed it is or how simple it is. For me, I will probably end up keeping this setting around 10, maybe 10 to 20. That's going to give me a really nice basic transition without removing too many of the details. Now, in this case, there are a lot of really fine hairs that I would have to work around. I'd probably set it lower for this particular image. But for a general setting, I'm probably going to keep it around 10%. I'll go ahead and reset this mask, and let's go ahead and go over the transition setting. Now, the best way to think of transition is at 0, you're going to have a harsher edge, and at 100%, you're going to have a softer edge. Now, it's not going to really blur the edge. If you want to add blur, you'll want to use the actual blur tool. This is going to determine the transition from masked to non-masked areas. And again, this setting is going to be dependent on the image you're using. For this photo, I have very soft lines around the hair, so I probably would not use a transition of 0. But I have it set to 0. I'm going to zoom in one more time. They're using that Command plus key, and I'm going to show you what the difference is. So if I were to click once over the edge, you can see that now I have a very pixely edge. That transition, it's not very soft. It's very jagged and kind of crunchy. I'm going to undo that. Now let's go to 100%. We'll just go to that extreme. And if I click again, now I have a really nice soft transition. And this is really ideal for a lot of the things that I'm going to be masking. So I'll probably keep it here unless I'm masking something that has very, very sharp lines or is very in focus. Then I may need to change this back to a lower setting. So those are the new features in Perfect Mask. I think it's a really great addition to the software, and it's just something to keep in mind when you're using the Perfect Brush so you can really fine-tune and customize your masks.